Alright, what is up YouTube? It is K-Rod here. I'm back with another good video for today. Let's talk about Ryan Garcia and Devin Haney and Teofimo Lopez. We're going to probably talk about Ryan Garcia first, as it had been reported that Ryan Garcia is no longer fighting Jojo Diaz for another pointless mandatory position spot for the WBC mandatory title shot, you know, eliminator, which is pretty stupid on both ends. I don't understand why Jojo even went through with this fight. Obviously, we did hear that he was supposed to fight Devin Haney, and he said it on air on the Boxing Voices YouTube channel in the past to Bill Haney on a live, I guess, like, interview, per se. And he told Bill that I will fight Devin Haney, but he has to check with his team and blah, 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 and see where things go. And that never came to be true, because Jojo Diaz obviously never spoke with his team, or there wasn't any update from his team of him saying, all right, we want to fight Devin Haney, and whatever happens, happens. And that just never became the case, because Devin Haney was very tempted in getting this fight to be made, because he's been ducked by the last 3 to 4 opponents, if you will, prior to Jojo Diaz, where Ryan Garcia avoided him, Javier Fortuna avoided him, Luke Campbell didn't want any smoke with Devin Haney, even though that he said that he did, but you know, like, we obviously knew that that wasn't to be the case, because if you kind of think about it, Lomachenko, he basically revacated his belt, and he basically made the excuse to say that, oh, he didn't want to fight Devin Haney because he wanted to go elsewhere, you know, in other divisions. But that's simply not true, because Lomachenko, he, you know, he was supposed to fight Devin in the first place, and you know, he never wanted to fight him, because he was like, okay, well, I rather just kind of just, you know, wait for, you know, the WBC to approve my request to become the franchise world champion, and then boom, there we go. But leading up to the Luke Campbell fight, it, for those of you that don't know, Devin Haney was supposed to fight Luke Campbell on August 31st of 2019, but Lomachenko basically pulled the white flag ducking card, where he basically vacated the WBC, and then he fought back for the WBC again. Because for those of you that don't know, or actually no, I stand corrected. Lomachenko never got the WBC until he beat Luke Campbell for the WBC. So Devin Haney was supposed to fight Luke Campbell for the belt, as far as I remember. But Lomachenko said, to hell with you, I'm going to request the WBC franchise belt, so that way, once I win the belt, I can just vacate it immediately, but I'm not going to let you fight for it against me. And then once you get the belt, Lomachenko basically holds franchise status, so whatever he wants to do next, that's on him. And that's so stupid, but it's so smart at the same time, because Lomachenko, he had so many opportunities to fight Devin Haney. But now that I think about it, Devin Haney, he got screwed over so bad, and I don't understand why the WBC allowed Lomachenko to go for the franchise status, or more so, Mauricio Suleiman selected him, because him and Canelo are the pioneers of that shit. But either way, you can see, like, my point here. Like, Lomachenko is just not this good fighter that we all want to be fooled by. And it's just not true, because it's like, if he was that good, like, be honest with me, guys. If Lomachenko was that good, don't you think he would have beat Devin Haney by now? Don't you think Devin Haney would have benefited from a Loma loss? And he probably would have been still, like, one of, like, yeah, right? You know, he still would have been, like, one of the most dangerous lightweights ever to come up in the division. Because if we look at Devin Haney's resume leading up to his very first title shot for him to earn the WBC title, it pretty much shows that Devin Haney had everything going. His whole career was just set from the beginning. So what I'm seeing here is that his very first title that he was supposed to get was supposed to be the WBC. And then leading up to his WBC interim title bout against Zaur Abdualov after the Antonio Moran and the Zolozani Nogadeni fight, where he got actually no, he got three good victories. He defeated Juan Carlos Burgos, he knocked out Mason Menard, he basically retired him in the corner, and yeah, leading up to the Antonio Moran fight, he was just dominating everybody. He was beating up everybody. But leading up to the Zaur Abdualla fight, that was supposed to be Luke Campbell. Believe it or not, it was supposed to be Luke Campbell. And then what happened after that? He wasn't able to get the Luke Campbell fight, and Lomachenko took it from him. So the WBC International Lightweight title, or the mandatory position spot, or the pre-mandatory position, because for some weird reason, once you get the international lightweight or the international belt, you have to work to get the interim belt, and then you're a mandatory, which, that isn't true. You're just basically called up by the WBC, but if they give you a call to fight for the interim title, then you can understand why they operate like that, because they just have such a weird ass system. It's not, it's not very consistent, and it's very, how should I say? It's very backwards in how they operate. But either way, Devin Haney was supposed to fight Luke Campbell for the WBC vacant title, but Lomachenko requested the WBC franchise belt so that way he can get the belt before Devin, and then it makes all the sense in the world why Devin would want to go after Lomachenko and not get his, or basically not be able to get his credibility in having his belt right away. So I don't know, man. Like, honestly, like, where things are with Devin's career, he's been treated like dirt, or he's just been treated like crap. And I feel bad because Devin Haney, he worked super hard to get up to that level, and I have nothing but a lot of respect for him because he definitely did everything that he could to get his world title shot, and now he's on his third, or he has defended his title successfully three times, and now it'll be a fourth title defense depending on who he's going to fight. I would hope that the next possible opponents could be somebody like maybe a Michelle Rivera or a Richard Comey, which I heard Richard Comey is like not even interested in trying to fight Devin, which is kind of stupid because Richard Comey, he has like a lot to gain from a Devin Haney fight, but it's like it just kind of shows like nobody don't want to fight Devin because Devin, he is doing everything in his power to try to win the fight. And I would kind of hope that he knows what he's doing and wanting to have, let the best fights made at 135. But I kind of feel like it's just like a losing end battle because it's just like, like nobody ain't trying to fight you. And, it's just like, if it's a losing battle, then why stay inside the battlegrounds if nobody's not willing to go to war with you? Because that's like saying, like, if this country don't want to fight this country for X amount of reasons, then you have to basically respect it because those nations themselves that have political indifferences obviously just can't deal with that type of, pressure. But I understand why Devin Haney is being avoided at all costs because it's a business threat decision that a lot of people know what's going to happen. Like, Devin Haney will give you a good payday, but is it worth a loss on the resume as you, as like a hopeless fighter that actually looks at that? Or just somebody on the, you know, like, you know, on the other side of coincidentalist fighters, which I wouldn't say coincidentalist. I would say guys that are definitely on the hopeless, because a hopeless fighter would not want to fight a coincidentalist, but coincidentalist fighters would not have a problem fighting other coincidentalist fighters unless it's for, you know, about the right reasons, per se. So I think where things are in Devin's career, he definitely knows what is at stake, but you know, there's really nothing I could really be mad about, because Devin, he's doing his thing, man. I definitely respect let the living crap out of Devin, and I think you know, if he can't get a fight with at least Michelle Rivera or somebody of a good lightweight caliber, then I guess Maxie Hughes will just be like the next victim in line that he'll just go after. But if it's going to be Maxie Hughes, I wouldn't mind that fight. Maxie Hughes is a decent opponent. He's not, like, the best fighter, you know, as far as, you know, resume goes. But he is somebody that can definitely give Devin some, you know, bit of issues to solve. You know, that the puzzle isn't really that difficult for him. But either way, I'd like to see where things go for Devin's career. And it will be interesting to see where he's going to be evolved into. Because I think where he's at now, like, I think he's growing into such a dangerous fighter that it's just not going to matter, because where he's growing in his state as a fighter, he just has so much to prove that is definitely going to be, you know, slept on, you know, for the rest of the lightweight division. But I kind of feel like he just needs to leave lightweight, and he just needs to go up to 140, so that way he has like a bigger say to do the things that he needs to do, and then he'll be ready. Because, you know, but the problem is just simply that Devin, he just, you know, he obviously just doesn't have, you know, let the proper you know, matchmaking set up in front of him, which makes it harder for him to, you know, to win his fights, or to get the tougher fights that he wants. So I don't know, it'll be interesting to see where Devin's at in his career, and hopefully you know, we could see something like that in the future, where he's going up against guys like Gervonta Tank Davis, or maybe a, I don't know, maybe Shannard Bunch. I would like to see that fight. Or maybe a guy like, I don't even know, man. There's just so much smoke, you know, in the window for him. But either way, I think Devin, he has a lot going on well for his career. So I'm not so worried about it. And I hope he does everything right for his career. But let's talk about Lion Ryan Garcia. And let's talk about what's been happening lately. Because, you know, Ryan Garcia, he's been on a capdemic train for quite some time, and you know, he's been pretty stupid lately, so hasn't been making the right decisions as a professional, where he says he was going to fight JoJo, and JoJo Diaz obviously was off the table, because he knew damn well that's going to be a risk, so he ducked that fight, and now there's reports saying that he could fight Gamboa, which I don't even think Gamboa is a good fight. I think that is really terrible for Ryan, but I'm not really against it, because I guess if Gamboa is somebody to get you prepared to at least see where you're at against a rough, rugged fighter, which I think Gamboa, he's going to come with everything to win, because he's not going to let Ryan Garcia beat up on him. I think Ryan Garcia, he will stomp him if he boxes smart. But either way, Gamboa, he is a great fighter, amazing veteran. And, you know, like, whatever goes for his career, it'll be interesting. But either way, Ryan Garcia, if he does continue to do this Canelo Alvarez ducking train saga. It's not going to go well for him, just simply because, like, where he's been in his career now, it's just not going to go well. And I just kind of think, like, where he's at right now, he's definitely not turning into, like, a good fighter. And I think, you know, the end is near when he's going to get knocked off by somebody that definitely wants to knock his head off. Because I definitely know a couple guys that definitely want to beat him up. And I think Nestor Bravo will be the first victim that will give Ryan his devastating L. But either way, let's talk about Mr. Teofimo Lopez, where we just recently saw Triller make a really, really bad decision in trying to sue George Kambosos for him not agreeing to the fight date change for the Teofimo Lopez fight, which, you know, I have nothing but hatred for Teofimo, simply because Teofimo, he's really made himself into a fool. And I think where he's been in his career, he's obviously made himself into a joke. And I don't think things are going well for the rest of his career. I think he has gotten too power hungry, and he's thought of himself to be like this big macho man type of guy where he just can't be touched, and I guess he thinks he's at the king of the lightweight division, which I find that hard to believe, because he only fought one king. You've only fought Vasyl Lomachenko, and that's pretty much it. Like, you really haven't fought anybody good in the lightweight division, but that's yet to be determined, because if you were to already had fought Devin Haney, let's just say if you had beat him the first time and Devin had a rematch and he beat you the second time, and let's just say you beat Devin, you know, the third time, that would be a little bit interesting. I would definitely like to see that, but we can't know that until y'all fight. So I don't know, man. I think Devin Haney, I think he understands, like, what's at stake here. He's just not the type of fighter that we all want to, or Teofimo, I'm sorry, Teofimo Lopez is not the fighter that, you know, that we can all say he's that good until he starts facing the tougher level opposition. And for him to call himself undisputed, that's another problem too. He's not undisputed. He is the unducksputed champion. He is the champion that is avoiding all the best competition out there, because even though that he has a lot of offers on the table, he's just not taking them. You know, if he's that good, you know, he should be fighting Vasyl Lomachenko. That definitely would have been a good fight to see. And I definitely wouldn't mind a Devin Haney fight. He should get Devin Haney out the way if he's that easy. I think that definitely needs to happen. But other fights down the line, maybe Jose Valenzuela, you had some history with him. I actually wouldn't mind that fight. I think it would be nice to see him in the ring with maybe Michelle Rivera. That would be a good fight. I actually even wouldn't mind to see maybe, I don't know, maybe Isaac Cruz Gonzalez. Obviously, George Kambosos is definitely the biggest fight of his career. I think that fight's going to be interesting and competitive. And I think where things are in his career right now, he just has a lot of, you know, things to grow. It's like nothing to really shade against him. It's just like he's not at his highest peak yet. And, you know, I think where he's at right now, he has a lot to work on as far as skills go, because he's obviously not that good yet. But, you know, like, once he gets his skills up, then he'll definitely, you know, explain a lot more questions to be answered. And I think where he's at right now, he's definitely doing what he has to do. So I'll be surprised to see where he's at, you know, for the rest of his, you know, career over at lightweight. But, or I guess, like, rest of career in general. I'm sorry, but either way, it's going to be interesting to see where he's at, because where he's at right now, he has a lot of room to grow. And like I said, once he fixes his flaws, I think that's when things will start to be a lot better for him. So, you know, it'll be interesting to see that. So, either way, I'll see you guys later. Let me know what you guys think about Devin Haney's future, Teo's future, and Ryan's future. Anyways, I'll just get going, and I'll see you guys around. Thank you very much. Goodbye.